Hello, hello again. Tony here, back on my channel once more, this time with another deck profile. Continue on with our coverage of Phantom Rage, the deck that we're going to be focusing on this week will be the new TCG exclusive in Mutants. So what are Mutants? Mutants is a deck that operates very similar to Cosmos in that they give up their smaller monsters to access their bigger monsters, with their bigger monsters gently floating into the smaller monsters upon their destruction. Unlike Cosmos, however, Mutants operates on the principle of mutation. What you generally do is, using one of your smaller monsters, you provide a stimulant in the form of another card to access different boss monsters depending on what you provide it with. And you use these different boss monsters with their varying effects to control the board and beat down your opponent. And despite what was perceived to be a rather underwhelming first wave of support, I've learned through testing at different angles for this deck that this deck is actually extremely well designed. While no individual card in this archetype is outright broken, each card in this deck provides a unique kind of micro advantage that, when combined, actually produces an extremely cohesive playstyle for Mutants. And that's something that can't be said for a lot of decks in their first wave of support. And I want to showcase that as I get to the deck profile. Anyway, I've drawn on enough. Without a further ado, let's get into the deck profile. Starting off our deck profile, we have three Mutant M05. M05, with the M standing for monster, searches for any mutant monster upon summon. And while you think that effect can be extremely useful, given the current limited card pool of cards that you would actually search with M05, it's actually extremely lackluster. See, most of your bigger mutant monsters would prefer to be in the deck so that you can access them from the deck, and any other mutant monster you would search otherwise can't be extended onto the field unless you have additional cards for support. As such, in most cases, M05's purpose is to access one of your three mutant ST46. ST46, with the ST standing for Spell and Trap, searches for any mutant Spell and Trap upon summon. These Spell and Traps are your general extenders, playmakers, and protection, and as such, you want to see ST46 as soon as possible to access those cards so that you can actually begin playing your real mutant strategy. These two monsters also share a common effect, whereby tributing themselves and banishing one card from your hand or face upon the field, you can summon a monster from a deck depending on the card you banished. If you banished a monster, you can summon out a mutant beast. If you banished a spell, you can summon out a mutant mist. And if you banished a trap, you can summon a mutant arsenal from your hand or deck. These three monsters are your mutant boss monsters. In terms of card effects, each of these mutant boss monsters has targeted protection against the card used to make it. For example, Beast was made using a monster and thus cannot be targeted by monster effects. Mist, being made by spells, cannot be targeted by spell effects, and Arsenal, being made by traps, cannot be targeted by trap effects. Furthermore, each of these boss monsters also has a reactionary effect that responds to a card different than the card used to make it. Beast, in response to a spell, can banish a card from your hand or your field to negate that spell and banish it. Mist, in response to a trap, can banish a card from your hand or field to draw two cards. While Arsenal, in response to a monster effect, can banish a card from your hand or field to target one monster on the field and banish it. In terms of playability, it's pretty clear to see that Mutant Mist here is the worst of the three mutant monsters. With a non-existent targeting protection effect and a pretty crummy disruption effect in a draw 2, you only play the one Mist because at certain situations you may actually banish a spell to summon it out for a beater. In most cases, however, you'll either be summoning out one of your two mutant beasts or your two mutant arsenal. And while you may think Beast is the centerpiece of the deck, in most cases you're actually summoning out Arsenal more than Beasts. And that's because while Beast is powerful with its targeting effect protection against monster effects as well as spell negation, in a monster heavy format there's actually not a lot of ways for Beast to interact with your opponent's board on their turn. Arsenal, on the other hand, responds to monster effects by banishing them and thus can be extremely disruptive on your opponent's turn. Furthermore, in terms of ratios, the reason I'm playing two of this and two of this and only one of this is also reflective on the ratios of the other cards in my deck. I'm playing an extremely high trap and monster count, but a very limited spell count, and that's because of the way that my mini mutants consume cards to summon out my bigger boss monsters. See, one of the biggest limitations with mutants at the moment is in the way they summon out their boss monsters. Each of these mini mutants tribute themselves and banish a card from my hand or face up on my field as a cost to activate an ignition effect. What this means is that, unlike a card like Droplets, where I can activate a card and then chain Droplets to sack the burnt resource as cost for this, any resource I'm consuming for my mini mutants is a live resource. This leaves me with two hard choices. Either I banish a card in my hand in which I forgo activating the card, or I banish a card face up on my field that has stuck on the field to summon out my boss monsters. And this in turn determines why I'm playing a lower spell count but a higher trap and monster count. See, all my spells in the deck are things that don't stick to the field, and I'd rather activate them than consume them for my mutant effects. And as such, I'd be playing the one mist for the limited spell count. However, my trap spin can be continuous, and as such I can flip them up and consume them later, and likewise, most monsters in the deck naturally stick to the field, and thus both of them serve as decent fodder options for to summon out my mutant monsters. And that as a result means I'm playing a higher beast and arsenal count to compensate. Now that we have that explanation out of the way, we move back into the deck profile with the last mutant monster we're playing into mutant GB88. GB88, with the GB standing for Grave and Banish, operates very similar to the other mutant monsters in the way it consumes resources to summon out a mutant boss monster. Unlike the mini mutants though, this one only triggers as a trigger effect when it's special summoned on your opponent's turn. See, when it's special summoned on your opponent's turn, it can consume a resource from your hand or face up on the field to summon back a level 8 mutant from your graveyard or your banished. And this in turn makes GB88 an extremely powerful form of recursion that allows you to be a little more overzealous with your boss monster's effects. In most cases, I can have a boss monster consume itself to activate its disruption effect, and then in the same turn summon out my GB88, consuming another resource to bring back that boss monster at no cost. And while GB88 can special summon itself from the hand while you have an evolution lab on the field, in most cases there's actually a bunch of ways you can actually cheat him out on your opponent's turn likewise to do a lot of wonky plays too. Rounding off the monsters, we're playing the only acceptable hand trap for this deck in our Psyframe Gamma package. Since a lot of situations you'll be tributing your mini mutants to summon out your bigger mutants, thus leaving your board empty, you can easily activate Gamma in response to a hand trap to protect your plays. Furthermore, as an additional benefit, since Gamma summons out two monsters, you can also use those two monsters as additional consumption fodder to summon out more boss monsters if you're interested. Moving into the spells, we start off with our three Mutant Evolution Lab. Evolution Lab, when activated, allows you to special summon one mini mutant from your hand or banished. Furthermore, once per turn, I can take one mutant monster in my hand, put it to the bottom of my deck to draw a new card. Now, while the last effect is clearly meant to shuffle back your bricked mutant boss monsters to see new cards, I've noticed that a lot of players seem to look at that first effect and try to build their deck around it. And this is why you may see some builds play things like Necroface or Gold Sarcophagus as a means of consistently resolving that first effect more often. I look at this card, however, and think it's better as a tempo card than anything else. In most cases, I can hold this card until I actually have a mutant banished so that I can then activate this card to summon out that mutant to get a continued play and a recovery. Otherwise, I'd rather keep this card in my spell and trap zone to continuously cycle out my bricks, or at worst consume it for a mutant mist. Regardless though, I definitely don't want to play this card as a playmaker because the amount of hoops and hurdles you have to go through to get a mini mutant banished and then have this card is so minute and specific that I'd rather keep this card as a tempo card instead to actively make the most out of it. Rounding off what is our pretty limited spell engine, we have the 1 E-Telly to search into our mini mutants, the 3 Pot of Extravagance because our X deck really doesn't matter and not in the way you think it does, and the 1 Call by the Grave to ensure our plays. Yeah. That's it. Going into the traps now, we start off with our 3 Mutant Expansion. Expansion, when activated, allows you to special summon or search one level 4 or lower mutant from your deck. Furthermore, should a mutant monster be destroyed by card effect, you could send this card to the graveyard instead. Now off of the first effect alone, this card is essentially a better E-Telly. Not only does this summon out a mini mutant that doesn't get banished on the end phase, the virtue of it being a continuous trap means that I can keep it around to actually consume it for my mutant effects whenever I want. In most cases, what I can do is that on my opponent's end phase, I can activate this card to summon out one of my mutant searchers, get the search off, and now on my following turn, consume both to summon out my mutant arsenal. Alternatively, on my opponent's turn, I can activate this card after I've already banished a mutant arsenal to summon out my GB88, consuming both cards to summon back that GB88 for recovery as well. Continuing on from there, we're playing 2 Mutant Clash. Clash, when activated, allows you to target one monster your opponent controls and banish one mutant from your graveyard to negate its effects until the end of the turn. And should one of your level 8 mutants run over a monster by battle, you can draw a card. And both of these effects are extremely good for the deck. Its first effect is not only monster negation that works really well with something like a beast, the fact that it banishes a mutant also sets you up for your evolution lab. The draw effect is also no joke either. The fact that your mutants are extremely big monsters means that you can run over your opponent's monsters really easily, and that draw can really well snowball you on your opponent really fast if they don't deal with it. Finally, by virtue of also being a continuous trap, it also can be consumed by your mutant monsters to summon an arsenal should you need to. Rounding off the mutant traps, we're playing two mutant Cry. Cry is a fusion trap that when activated allows me to summon one mutant fusion monster from my X deck using monsters on my field, graveyard, or banished. And like Evolution Lab, this card is one of the cards that players looked at and tried to build an entire deck around. And personally, like those other cards, I feel like this card is better as a recovery and tempo card than a playmaker. See, in the span of a long game, it can be pretty easy to end up with a bunch of your level 8s either banished or in the graveyard that you can't get back. And as such, Cry is a way for you to put back those level 8 mutants back into the deck to summon them with your mini mutants once more to apply additional pressure on top of the fusion that you summon. Now, before I proceed any further, I'd like to point out that one of the other limitations that mutants do have is in the way that they go neg to summon out their boss monsters. Regardless of if I'm banishing a mutant from my hand or my field, every time I activate my mini mutant's effects, I'm going neg 1 to summon out my boss monster. And in a long grindy game, being out resourced like that can be a problem. And this is why you see some players play things like the Nemesis Engine or the Thunder Engine as a means to alleviate that cost. I, on the other hand, have a different option. See, if I don't want to use my cards as resources, why not I use my opponent's cards instead? Cue the inclusion of 3 Crackdown and 3 Ice Dragon Prison. Both of these cards, while disruptive in their own right, also provide you the additional benefit of taking one of your opponent's resources and putting it onto your side of the field. And while in most decks that really doesn't do a lot outside of sit there, in the mutant deck I can then proceed to consume these resources to activate my mutant effects. For example, I can activate the Ice Dragon Prison, summoning back one of my opponent's monsters in the graveyard as a form of graveyard disruption, and then summon out an M05 to banish that monster along with the M05 to summon out a beast, effectively turning it into a summon a beast for a DD Crow. Or I can activate my Crackdown, taking one of my opponent's monsters on their turn, and then special summoning out a GB88 to consume that monster with my GB88 to bring back one of my mutant monsters, essentially turning it into a reborn that banishes one of my opponent's monsters. Or even in the best case scenario, if I already have one of my big mutants on the field, I can take one of my opponent's monsters and then use it as cost for my big mutant's effects, effectively turning it into a removal card that takes out 2 cards instead of 1. Rounding off the traps and the deck, we're playing 3 There Can Only Be One and 1 Skill Drain. These are the floodgates that most synergize with the deck. First off, most of your mutants are different types, and as a result, you can easily play under There Can Only Be One. Likewise, since most of your mutants tribute or banish themselves as costs, they can dodge Skill Drain at any time. But worst comes to worst, if I did need to turn them off, I can always consume them for my mutant effects to actually turn them off at any point, effectively allowing me to play under these cards or off these cards whenever I want. Moving on to the X deck, we have our 3 Mutant Synthesis. Synthesis can be made with any 2 mutants of different attributes, and 1 fusion summon allows you to target 1 card on your opponent's side of the field and destroy it. Furthermore, should your opponent activate a card or effect, you can make this card immune to that type of card, i.e. monster, spell, or trap, until the end of the turn. And should he be destroyed, allows you to add back any banished mutant to your hand. See, the first 2 effects work out really well for each other. You can summon this card off of something like Cry and then target one of your opponent's cards on their turn. And then should your opponent tries to protect that card or negate this card's effect, you can make it immune to that card type, assuring you get the pop off. However, what's more important here is the 2 materials that you need to make it. 2 mutants of different attributes can either be a mini mutant or a large mutant, or more than likely, 2 different mutant boss monsters. This, along with Cry, serves as one of the ways you can shuffle back your boss monster mutants to ensure that your mini mutants have something to summon from the deck later. The other mutant fusion we play is 2 Mutant Ultimus. Ultimus requires 3 level 8 mutants to make, so he's a little harder to make, but he comes with a negation effect, where if your opponent activates a card or effect, you can banish one mutant card from your graveyard, field, or hand of the same card type, i.e. monster, spell, or trap, to negate that effect. Furthermore, should he be destroyed, you can add back 3 mutant cards of different card types, i.e. monster, spell, and trap, to your hand. See, it's pretty hard to actually make this card given getting 3 mutants in the banished or in the graveyard can be a little difficult. So in most cases you make this card only as a last resort to shuffle back your boss monster mutants, but also end on a decent beater. Ultimately, you don't need this card more than you need something like Synthesis, but you do want to play this on the off chance you have enough mutant boss monsters banished to drop this hunking monster to end your turn and end your game. Now the remainder of this X deck is more things we play because we play the Psyframe Gamma package than we actually will use on mutant plays. In most cases, you'll just banish these cards off of Extravagance, but on the off chance you do get to resolve that Gamma, it's still good to have these cards. We have the 1 Psyframe Lambda in case you open double Gamma, we have the Nightburst Cerberus and Phoenix for that pop effect, we have the Krishan Hauka Firebrax because Gamma's a tuner so you do get Hauka Firebrax plays, we have the 1 Crosssheet because you make Synchros and Fusion in this deck so you can abuse both effects, we'll play the 1 Link Cross as part of the Hauka Firebrax engine, we play the 1 Omega that we can make off of just the Gamma alone, we have the 1 Time Lord Vulgate which we can make using a level 8 mutant and the Gamma, we have the 1 Herald of Arclight as part of that combo, which we'll most likely made using our last card, the Metal Marcher. And that's gonna do it for our mutant deck profile. Honestly, after the amount of testing I've done for this deck, I honestly believe that this deck is probably one of the best designed decks that Konami has released for a TCG exclusive. Every card in this deck does something, and it does something effective enough to make them all really playable. And I definitely see a lot of potential for this deck in the future on a regional and maybe even a high competitive level. Regardless, my name is Tony Yang, this has been a Mutant Deck Profile, I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I will see you guys next time.